Good morning and happy Sabbath. Oh, we can do better than that. Good morning and happy Sabbath. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Shall we pray? Oh Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. We thank you so much for the privilege of prayer that we can call upon your name. We thank you for Jesus who came to be our means of salvation. We thank you for your comforter who came to be with us. And we ask, Lord, that as we embark on our praise and worship this morning, that you look beyond our faults and see our needs, oh Lord. Thank you. Send your angels to sing with us and be with us. Accept our praise this morning, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Spirit, fill
Spirit is our theme today. So in our music, in our worship, in our praise, in our readings, we are looking to learn more of God's Holy Spirit, to receive more of God's Holy Spirit, and to be empowered by God's Holy Spirit working in our lives. Thank you.
Take a pause, bow my face and all, and the door is
in the house of the Lord, this is where rest is restored. I invite you to stand with us. Oh, come, let us adore him. This is the place where he dwells with us. Come, let us adore him.
Presence today to worship you. We invite your Holy Spirit to be here today to open our hearts and minds so that we can receive the blessing that awaits us. Thank you for your goodness and for your love for us, dear Lord, and for bringing us here today. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Come and live. This is Focus on CAA. CAA, in my opinion, has been the major outreach of the Columbia First Church for a number of years. Several years ago, I was the CAA board chairman, and through surveys and town hall meetings, got feedback from some of you, as well as other people who had children in CAA or had in the past. And one thing that became clear at that time was that, in general, people were very happy with the spiritual atmosphere and spiritual training that their children got. So the question is, why are we as a church at the crossroads when it comes to CAA because of low enrollment? One thing that I have heard is that perhaps Adventist education may limit our professional opportunities, may jeopardize our professional future. So we have three gentlemen here who all have, I'm including myself, who have had a combination of Adventist education as well as state education. So I'll briefly tell you my background and my answer to the question, has Adventist education jeopardized my professional future? My first 7 years of education were in the public school system. We then became Seventh-day Adventist and had the pleasure of moving to Hawaii, where for the first time I attended an Adventist school. That was Kailua Mission School. And then the next 2 years were at Hawaiian Mission Academy. After that, we moved back to the States. My father was in the Marine Corps, and I graduated from Mount Pisgah Academy, went on to Southern Missionary College at the time, Southern Adventist University now, and then on to Loma Linda University School of Medicine. After that, my education was in the public sector. I interned in Louisiana, did my neurology residency in Chapel Hill, and obtained some degrees and additional training at the University of South Carolina. I do not believe that my Adventist education and background in any way jeopardized my professional career and future. And on the other hand, it has given me some solid values and a lot of friends that I keep in touch with today. Gary?
This is Dr. Gary Ewing.
Hi. You know, I grew up in a public system, a school system, and converted to being a Seventh-day Adventist back in 1985. And I started seeking out to get into medical school at that time. And I got accepted at a couple different places, including Loma Linda. I got accepted at Dartmouth. And I elected to go ahead and go to Loma Linda University for the first time in my life to have any, you know, exposure to an Adventist education. And it really changed my life in a really profound way. It did the opposite of limiting my opportunity. It expanded them greatly. Some of the ways it did that is, I started doing a little bit of mission work, and there was a lot of opportunity for that within the Adventist school, and they made that readily available. But in addition to that, it was the relationships that I forged and the idea of trying to exhibit excellence in your work. And I think that was really emphasized to such a degree that it helped influence me for the rest of my career. And also, I was able to go on to other schools that were outside the Adventist system, and they welcomed us with open arms. I was able to attend the University of Pennsylvania, which is considered an Ivy League school, and get my occupational medicine residency completed, and only was met with welcoming arms any place I've ever gone as a result of my Adventist education. And it's been very profound in the relationships I've made, and also in the opportunities that it's afforded me. So it's been a really positive thing for me, not just to find God in this institution, but also to find the opportunities that the educational system brought for me.
This is Dr. Michael Sigsworth. Michael?
Well, I went to, I've always grown up Adventist. I went to a smaller elementary school growing up, and it was in the greater Collegedale area in Tennessee. And after that, went on to Collegedale Academy, and then from there, Southern Adventist University, and then from there, went to Loma Linda University School of Medicine. And then from there, I'm doing my residency here in psychiatry. And I can't think of any part of my Adventist education, even though I went to a smaller school, K through 8, that had a negative impact on my life. And I can just think of a lot of the positive relationships that I forged with some of my teachers there that have had long-lasting impacts on my life and in my spiritual life. I think when we think about education, it's important to think about how relationships and how the activities that we're doing in the school setting affect the overall trajectory of our life rather than academics. That's not to negate the importance of academic excellence, but that we have to think about the eternal spectrum and think more about those lines when we think about where we'd be sending our kids. So I think that's kind of my thought on it. Today's scripture reading is going to be found in John 14, verses 16 through 20. And while y'all are looking for that, I just have a few things I'd like to say. One thing that I really appreciate about this church is how warm and welcoming it's been to us over the last 3 years being here. A couple weeks ago, had family in from out of town, and some of them haven't been to church in years. And they were struck with how cohesive our church is and how warm and welcoming, and they had multiple people who went up to them and greeted them, and they were really struck by that. And I think that's something that only happens as a result of the Holy Spirit working in each of our lives. And I just want to continue to encourage y'all to think about that and continue to help grow in that area. As I read our scripture for today, my hope and prayer is that I won't get in the way of it, and that God will speak to each of your hearts. Again, it's John 14, verses 16 to 20, and I'll be reading from the New King James Version. "And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever, the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you. A little while longer, and the world will see me no more, but you will see me. Because I live, you will live also. At that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you."
Said that he would be with us, that he would never leave us. But sometimes life gets in the way of our relationship with God. We push him away because we're too busy. We push him away because we have other things to do, we have other people to see, other goals and pursuits. But God said if we seek Him first, that He'd add everything that we need to us.
Amen.
But we only have one job, and that's to seek God. How many of you want more of God this morning?
Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, sing.
Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God.
Set a fire.
Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God.
Set a
fire down in my soul that I can't contain,
that I can't control.
I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God.
Set a fire
down in my soul that I can't contain, I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God.
Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God.
I want more of you,
set
God.
A fire.
Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, I can't control. I want more of you, God.
Somebody else, anybody, no matter who, because He had done something for you, that He laid His hand on you. We're living in a time now where that fire needs to be set. Can't control it. Don't need to control it. Because He does. Can't contain it. You got to tell somebody. Because He's done something for you. And you don't want somebody to miss out on that. Not only do I want us to know, I want my friends that don't know either to know. Because I don't want to get there and I have one of my friends who's very sassy and go, why didn't you tell me? Ask God to set that fire within our souls. Beg Him for more. Because of Jesus, we can come boldly through to the throne of God. I want more of you. In the meantime, hide me, Lord, because I'm not worthy. Hide me, because I know I messed up this week. Hide me, because I should have said something and I didn't. Set a fire in my soul. I can't contain it. I can't control it. I don't want to control it. I want more of you.
Father God, we praise you, Lord, because you are the God that created us, who gave us breath from nothing, who gave us the opportunity to be here. And Lord, despite being a fallen race, you chose to send your precious Son to redeem us wretches. Thank you, God, for your compassion and your mercy. And Lord, living here is not always easy. We have beautiful days, Lord, but sometimes the rain falls. We ask that you be with Miss Quinn. And that the Holy Spirit will comfort her. May she feel the presence of the Comforter in her heart today. And others in our congregation that are experiencing or have experienced loss recently, Lord. May they feel your presence today too. Father, we praise you for your goodness, for the babies here in the congregation, born and unborn, for the friends and family here in the congregation. Lord, we ask that your Holy Spirit descend into your church today and be present in our worship and enter into our hearts anew. We have a prayer request in for Doris Jackson's daughter, Samantha, who had a blood clot. Father, you are the great physician, Lord, and we trust you with this situation. And we ask for your faith. That no matter what happens in this situation and in any situation in our lives, that this is not the end of the story. We already know the end, and it is a happy ending. We ask you to be with Miss Wanda Amick, who is in pain, Father, and she's tired. You have promised rest for the weary, Lord, and comfort for those who are hurting. We claim that promise today. We also ask that you be with all of our Pathfinders as they are on their camping trip, Father. We pray for their health and their safety, and for their fun, but most importantly, for their spiritual growth. May they see you in a new light, and may they walk closer with you. Please bless the rest of our service today, and help our hearts to be open to receive the beautiful music and the message from the Bible, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning again. If money were no object, and as a parent, you desired to give the very best gift to your children, what would it be? What do you think? Certainly a good education is something you would want for your children. And I appreciate the thoughts that were shared for the Mission Spotlight on CAA. I feel duty-bound and obligated to just share a little bit more personally about that. My parents had an opportunity to give me the best education money could buy. And the good news for them was that they wouldn't have to pay for it. I was working at a very nice school in Charlotte when I was a young man, and one of the gentlemen gave me an invitation. Said, "Carlton, I think you can be somebody one day. And I would like for you to go to school here. And I'm going to make it so that you don't have to, well, we'll work it out. We'll figure out something. We'll get you a scholarship. We'll figure it out." Great news. Best school in town. Don't know what he was under the influence of that day, but he felt like that was an opportunity he should extend to me. So I took that good news home and I shared it with my parents. My mother was the one I saw first, and I shared with her mom. Answer to your prayers. I get to go to the best school in town, and the better news is you and Dad don't have to worry about paying for it. After all, hey, you're church school teachers. No, don't need this added burden. And the answer was very brief and direct from my parents. My mother, in fact, asked me if I told the gentleman I already had plans. And of course, I had not. I don't know if I ever talked to the gentleman again, but basically, I learned a lesson from that experience, is that what God has for you is better than anything anybody else could ever offer. And it's even better to trust him to provide the means to pay for it if you can. And if that's what he wants for you, he'll make a way to provide that for you. And my parents trusted God to do that. Through my time in school, through my time in college. And by the way, the hope and the dreams that the gentleman had for me that I could achieve, I was able to do that using God's plans and not his plans. I'm grateful for the opportunity that was extended to me, but I am more grateful for my parents' demonstration of faith in God's plan and in Adventist Christian education. And I've been able to see and realize that God can make a way and he can open doors, and the things that he desires for you, he can grant them to you by trusting in his plan for your life. If you could give your children the best thing that they could receive, what would it be? Certainly a good education would be on that list. Maybe a trust fund would be nice. A nice home and some land is a gift that we'd love to have, we'd love our children to have, a wonderful God-fearing spouse, if only we could give to our children. A good paying job, a good healthy body, and safety. If we could do that for our children, we would do it in a heartbeat. But here's the fact and the reality is that no matter how good of a parent we are, we're no match are no comparison to the wonderful parent that God is to us. And this is what Jesus had to say about parenting roles comparing earthly parents and our Heavenly Father. In Luke 11, verses 11 through 13, Jesus said, "Which of you fathers, if your son asks for a fish, will give him a snake instead? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?" Luke chapter 11 begins by Jesus giving the model prayer to his disciples. He further continues and gives a parable about the importance of persistence. And he culminates that section by saying, if we learn how to pray, and if we're determined, and if we ask, God promises to give us the best gift we could receive that far exceeds any earthly gift that we could ask for or that we could give to our children. And that is the gift of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
It is now time for our children's story. I heard somebody respond to that, so that means at least one child, is here today. So we are going to not disappoint that child. Please have your gifts of green and silver and copper ready for our children, or that child, making the rounds to gather the offering today. And we have someone who is ready to share a story with them. Thank you. They're on their way. Yeah, there he is.
I would like to tell y'all my name is Cynthia Clark. I started coming to church here last June. Prior to coming here, I prayed and asked God, what will I do? How will I be able to serve you? I'm old, my back's broke, and I didn't think I'd be able to do anything. He laid it on my heart to write short stories for the children. This was before I even knew there was a children's story. So I sat right down and wrote my first story of many, and I'm going to read it for the children today. Okay. Guys, this story is about flying a kite. You know what a kite is? Yeah. One day, Brian was spending the afternoon with his mother at the beach. She had provided a wind, God had provided a windy day, so he took his kite to fly. He was so excited. Brian, his mother said, I'll hold the kite up and you run to get some wind behind it so it flies. Well, Brian began to run and his mother let the kite go. For a moment, the kite flew, but all of a sudden, kaboom! The kite came crashing to the ground. They tried again. Kaboom! It crashed again. After the third try, Brian was becoming very discouraged and called out, why is this happening? Why won't my kite fly? The kite was not damaged, and he had plenty of string attached. There was lots of wind. All of a sudden, Brian heard a whisper in the wind. Look, Brian, you have forgot to attach the tail. Mother, mother, called Brian. We forgot to attach the tail. Oh, Brian, how could we have been so careless, answered his mother. They hurriedly attached the tail to the kite. Once again, his mother held the kite up, and Brian began to run. All of a sudden, the wind caught behind the kite, and it began to lift up. Pretty soon, it lifted higher and higher, and before it's above the trees, it was so high. What a sight to see. The kite was so beautiful, swaying in the wind, high in the sky above Brian's head. Brian settled down, holding tightly to the string to keep the kite from flying away. Mother smiled. She was so happy that Brian was having fun. Brian stood watching his kite fly. He had done it. He had succeeded in getting his kite to fly. Look, Mother, look. Look what I did. Isn't she grand, flying so high? Look what I did. His mother sat quietly in her beach chair with concern on her face. Brian spent the afternoon flying his kite until his mother called out, Come, Brian, it's time to go. They packed up the car, shook off the sand, and headed home. Mother, this was a great day. I had so much fun flying my kite, he said. Did you see what I did? Did you see how high my kite flew? Troubled with what Brian said, she replied, It was a wonderful afternoon. However, there are lessons to know in flying a kite. What are they? Brian asked. His mother answered, It bothers me, son, that you continue to say, I did, I did. I want you to realize it took many people helping before you could ever fly your kite. What do you mean? He said. I did do it. I did fly my kite. I flew it all by myself. Yes, you did fly your kite, answered his mother. However, God first provided the wind needed. Second, the kite would not fly until we attached the tail. The tail was needed to balance it so it wouldn't crash. The cloth the tail was made of had to be manufactured by other people. But before that cloth was woven, there were people who harvested the cotton from the farm. Oh, I see, replied Brian. Before the cotton was harvested, it had to be planted to grow by the farmer. Yes, his mother answered. You are such a smart young man to realize what is necessary to fly a kite. And don't forget the truckers. They must deliver the cloth to the stores that sell it to us. Without the cloth, we could not have made a tail which enables your kite to fly. So you see, it takes many people to fly a kite. There are many lessons in this story, and I would like to point out just two. First, all that we have belongs to God. He created all, and without Him, there would be no wind to lift the kite high in the sky. We need Him, and we also need other people helping. We cannot do anything alone. Second, we must have balance in our lives to be happy. The balance for the kite was the tail. The balance in our lives is Jesus. Though through Him, all things are possible. We must attach ourselves to Jesus and hold on to Him tight. Why? Because He loves you. He will keep you strong. He will keep you from crashing. Jesus is your balance in life. We must all be thankful, pray, and thank Him daily for all our blessings. Would you guys like to say what you thank Jesus for? Would you like to tell us?
What's your name?
Roy.
Roy, tell us. expecting to.
Huh?
I was expecting to. I don't know.
What about your bicycle? What about your toys he uses?
Yeah.
Yeah? And what about you? What's your name?
Matt.
And what are you thankful for?
I'm thankful for that we have water to drink every day.
Bless you. And your name?
Noah. I'm thankful for a TV, iPad, and chips.
Oh, God bless you. TV. Okay, now we have a song, a very special song for you guys.
Okay, Miss Cynthia asked us to sing a short little song, so we have adapted one. So see if you can hear the difference in the words.
Jesus loves the little children, came to save each little one. Let him guide you day and night, like the tail upon the kite. Jesus loves the little children of the world. Let him guide you day and night, like the tail upon the kite. Jesus loves the little children of the world.
Let's pray. Thank you, Father, for entrusting your children with us. They bring us all so much love and joy. We witness you daily through them. Please continue to bless them with good health, and Lord, keep them safe. We live in such troubled times. Wrap your arms around them and hold them close. Let them know you are the balance in their lives. Have them shine brightly for you. In your name I ask. Amen. Okay, I brought you guys kites. And I even asked Pastor Jason if you could take them home and put them together and bring them back next week and fly them in the yard after potluck, and he said, yes, you could. Thank you.
Happy Sabbath. What a pleasure it is to be in the house of God today. The offering today is for the local church budget. The offering appeal was written by Jeffrey Waite of the Lenore and Wilkesboro churches. Acts 1:8 says, "You will receive power when the Holy Ghost comes upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, and in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." Quite often, Jesus tells us our work begins at home. It is his desire to save every soul. This includes the ones near us, as well as the ones in the mission fields overseas. He has chosen to do his work through his people. We have an opportunity to do our part to finish the work locally, and by doing so, we hasten the coming of Jesus. As you return his tithes and give your thank offerings today for local church budget, know that those funds will be used in ministries right here to take the gospel throughout our city and community. When you bless others with your generous gift today, know that God has promised to bless you. He is faithful. It is all of us in response to all of him. Let us pray. Lord, we ask that you bless the offerings and multiply them like the loaves and the fishes, that your work may be done as quickly as possible to hasten the return of your Son. In your name we pray. Amen. And I was just going to share real quick, as long as we're talking about Adventist education. Dr. Durkin asked me, and I was racking my brain. but I would not be where I am today without La Sierra University, from which I was almost kicked out of. They said, if you want to stay, you need to write an apology letter. And I said, I'm going to make a bologna sandwich and I'm going to lay it on thick. And that's going to be the best apology letter that they have ever seen. Until I realized that what I was writing was true. And God spoke to me, and gave my heart back to Him. Praise God.
To thank you, Travis, for that testimony about the importance and power of Christian education in your life. I'd like to thank our musicians who've been sharing, Cherie and Barb and Harry and Teresa and our praise team. Want to thank you all for your ministry today in our service. And by the way, our pastor would certainly be excused if he were in or near Boston, Massachusetts, making arrangements and preparations, but I understand he's much closer to us than that. Irmo, at our sister church. So we are praying for our pastor and Irmo, and we're also praying for our pastor and Angela for their upcoming event. So we want to keep him and them in prayer. If you're not quite sure who the Holy Spirit is and what He does, you're not alone. You remember Nicodemus? Nicodemus was a church member, church leader, who'd been hearing and watching Jesus, and he realized that Jesus had something that he needed. So he had the courage to go see Jesus at night and talk to him a little bit. And before Nicodemus asked the question that was really on his mind, Jesus knew it and gave him the answer in John chapter 3. John chapter 3, verses 3 through 12, give that story, and I'll share some of that scripture. Jesus said to Nicodemus, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they're born again." Nicodemus responded, "How can someone be born again when they're already old? Surely they can't enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born." Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they're born of the water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You shouldn't be surprised at my saying you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you can't tell where it comes from or where it's going. So it is with the Holy Spirit." Nicodemus was a leader in the church, yet he did not fully understand his need or the working of the Holy Spirit.
But he was brave and humble enough to ask, and Jesus was willing to teach him. There's another story. Later, after the death and resurrection of Jesus, the Apostle Paul in Acts is on one of his missionary journeys, and he finds his way to Ephesus. And there he found some disciples, and he posed to them an interesting question. Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? This is found in Acts chapter 19, verses 1 through 6. After hearing that question, these disciples answered, "No, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." So Paul then asks, "Then what baptism did you receive?" "John's baptism," they reply. Paul said, "John's baptism was a baptism of repentance. He told the people to believe in one coming after him, that is Jesus. On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul placed his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke in tongues and they prophesied." Even though the disciples Paul met were completely ignorant of the Holy Spirit, they were willing to learn and they were teachable. And because they were willing to learn and be taught, they received the gift of the Holy Spirit, and their ministry realized power and effectiveness that it had not seen before. Whether you've never heard of the Holy Spirit, or you still don't quite understand how the Holy Spirit works in our lives, the good news is that the Bible has plenty to say about it. And by God's grace, through the study of His Word, and through the power of the Holy Spirit, we're able to learn and receive the Holy Spirit in our lives.
Believe he goes beyond my highest
stand amazed when I think that a King of glory should come to dwell within the heart of man. I marvel just to know He really loves me. When I think of who He is and who I am, for He's more wonderful than my mind can conceive. He's more wonderful than my heart can believe. He was beyond my soul ever longed for, everything He's promised, and so much more, more than amazing,
that's what my Jesus is,
more than marvelous,
that's what my Savior is,
more than miraculous,
that's what my God could ever be,
He's more than wonderful, that's what
Joy, thank you again for your wonderful music throughout the day and singing about our wonderful Savior, Jesus, our all in all, our everything. This is what Jesus was to His disciples. And they were not very pleased at all because He had announced He was leaving. They were hurt, sad, despondent, discouraged, upset, maybe mad that He was going away. But Jesus had some good news for them. In fact, He said, don't worry. Don't be discouraged, don't be upset, because this is what I'm going to do. Arrangements are already in place for you. John 14, 16 through 18 shares with us what Jesus said to His disciples, and Jesus told them, I'll pray the Father, and He will give you another comforter. Another comforter, meaning someone in Jesus' place. Another comforter that He may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world can't receive, because it seeth Him not, neither knoweth Him. But ye know Him, for He dwelleth in you and shall be in you. I won't leave you comfortless. I will come to you. So how is it that Jesus, who's far away and is leaving us and is in a place where we cannot see and touch Him, how can He be close to us? It's through the Holy Spirit, who Jesus has promised to be in us. So we are not left alone. As I was looking at scriptures that talk about the Holy Spirit, I saw 50 things that the Holy Spirit does. I saw 33 things. I only have 5 scriptures to share with you.
And I just share one of them with you. The second scripture I would like to share with you, John 16. John 16, beginning in verse 7, continuing through verse 15, and I'll share some of those scriptures. John 16, beginning in verse 7. Jesus again, communicating and talking with his disciples. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It's to your advantage that I go away. For if I don't go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. And when he's come, he will convict the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. Continuing to verse 13. When he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak of his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will tell you things to come. Verse 14, he will glorify me, for he will take of what is mine and declare it to you. Another verse that talks about the work of the Spirit is Galatians 5. Galatians 5, 22 and 23. It says, But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. When you look at these descriptions, they are a description of Jesus. And how do we become more like Jesus? It is by having the Holy Spirit live in us so our characters can be transformed and changed so that gradually we start to look more and more like Jesus. Don't know how it happens, don't know how it works, but it's kind of like Jesus told Nicodemus, it's like the wind blowing. Can't see it working, but we can see the results of it. It's like the wind that lifts the kite off the ground. The Holy Spirit works in our lives to transform our character into the likeness of Christ. Two more scriptures. One, Romans 8, 26 and 27. Romans 8, 26 and 27. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We don't know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the minds of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. We can't think straight, we can't talk straight, we can't pray straight. But the Holy Spirit takes what we try to offer to God and works with it and massages it and presses it and pieces it and packages it and puts it together to God as just what we need. And he does that for us. Without him, we have no connection with God. Last scripture I'd like to share with you. 1 Corinthians 12, 4 through 11. 1 Corinthians 12, 4 through 11. I'll read this chunk of scriptures. There are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of activities, but it is the same God who works in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another different kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues.
By one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each individually as he wills or as he chooses. So, do we need the Holy Spirit in our lives? Do we wish to be convicted of sin? Do we wish to be drawn to Jesus? Do we wish to have our prayers translated so that they're seeking what we actually need from God and they're acceptable to God? Do we need comfort? I don't know about you, but sometimes I've been known to worry just a little bit. Even with family, we can find a loneliness or a burden on occasion that even our mother or father or even our spouse can't help us with, that only Jesus can through his Holy Spirit. We got hurts, we have pain, we have disappointment, daily challenges. Jesus said, I'm sending you a comforter. I'm sending you a helper. If we need that, we need the Holy Spirit. Do you struggle with gaining the victory over sin? Do you need the strength to think and act more like Jesus? If so, I need the Holy Spirit. Our church, it's a diverse church. We got all kind of folks in our church. I'm one of them. But the Holy Spirit comes and he gives us gifts. He gives you something and he gives me something as he chooses so that we can be unified and so that we can work together to carry out the gospel commission. And what is the gospel commission? It's this, that we are to therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey all the things that we have learned of Christ. Well, we've heard a little bit more about the Holy Spirit, about who he is and about what he does. And the question is how we receive him if we actually desire him. And Jesus tells us it's pretty straightforward. So we'll start where we began. We'll go back and share this scripture that says, so I say to you, ask, and it shall be given. Seek, and you shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds. And to him who knocks, it will be opened. If a son asks for bread from any father among you, will he give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will he give him a serpent instead? Or if he asks for an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will our Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those of us who ask him? Dear Lord, it is our prayer today that we receive the gift of the Holy Spirit that you promise. We see, dear Lord, that we have a great need for the Holy Spirit in our lives. We ask you, Lord, that you would empty us of self, that you would make us teachable, humble, willing to realize our need, and we ask that you would fill us, dear Lord, with your Holy Spirit. Equip us with the gifts and talents that you see fit to give us so that we can carry out your commission to spread the good news about Jesus. We ask for that power, dear Lord, and we ask that we would keep our eyes on you and trust in you to be our all in all. In the worthy name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. With that, our closing prayer, we are dismissed. Thank you, worship leaders, again, for planning our program, and we pray that you will experience the upcoming week filled with the power of the Holy Ghost.